Every good story creates expectations. The plot hums along, characters are developed, they take flesh, and then you're led to a particular place of expectation. When the story is really good, when we're really engaged, these expectations, they crackle with electricity. You can't stop reading the book. You can't push pause on the remote. You just have to keep pushing along. Truly outstanding stories have at this moment of expectation a surprising twist that often just changes everything. That's how I felt in the movie theater when I saw Star Wars: The Empire Strikes Back. You know the scene. The movie hummed along. The characters were developed. Young Skywalker was trained up. And then there was this crackling moment of expectation, the long-awaited duel between Darth Vader and Luke Skywalker. And then that place of expectation that crackled with electricity, that sparked, all of a sudden exploded. And at the end of the combat, you heard Darth Vader say, "I am your father." No! No one saw that coming. And it changed everything. The whole story took on new meaning. Tonight's passage does the same exact thing. We as readers, we come to this story with certain expectations. John 13 makes the same transition from Jesus' public ministry to his final private moments of teaching with his disciples. All the Gospels have this triumphal entry and then this transition. And if you're familiar with the other Gospels and with Christian tradition, you know that at this point in the story, there's something that Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and all the Christian tradition have taken great pains to insert. This is the moment in the story of Jesus that the Lord's Supper is prominently placed. But instead of the Lord's Supper, the Gospel of John has this story of the foot washing. Now, of course, John knows about the Lord's Supper. In fact, at the point when we were discussing in John chapter 6, the feeding of the 5,000, there were clear allusions in that narrative, more than in any of the other gospel accounts, clear allusions to the communion moment. Jesus was being portrayed and developed in the miracle of the feeding of the 5,000 as opening up a table of hospitality. It wasn't just a miracle to wow the crowds. It was a teaching lesson about that final banquet day when God would open up his table to all the nations. So John knows that this is the moment in the story of Jesus that you're supposed to talk about the Lord's Supper. But he inserts this other story, not included in the other Gospels, because they had their own purposes and reasons. But John tells this other story of an event that occurred that night. It is an event that John intends the reader, in this surprising twist of the story, to have an aha moment. This is John's interpretation of the Lord's Supper. This is John's take on how we are to read and understand what takes place in a moment when we are going to celebrate the Lord's Supper. It is this interpretive key. And in this, what the Gospel of John is beckoning us to when we come to the table is a recognition that the table, like the foot washing, it's an invitation to Christ's humble love that welcomes us home. Now, you and I, we come from all different places this week. And we come to this table tonight with different expectations, different needs. Some need encouragement, Some are on the precipice of a crisis of faith. For some of us, we're doing fabulously, and we just can't wait to partake of this bread and wine as a celebration of God's joyful presence in our lives. Wherever and however we come to this table, we all come as humble recipients of God's love. Every spiritual dysfunction, every aspect of this fallen world, everything that goes awry, it all goes awry because we don't understand the love of God. If we were to truly grasp in the core of our being what we have taught our little kids to sing, "Jesus loves me, this I know." If we truly grasp that, then we are entering into the very heart of God Himself. What we do tonight in this story, in this humble foot washing story that extends a welcome home, is going into the very heart of God. And that is a holy and awesome thing. So let's join together as we go into this sacred moment and ask that God would bring us into His very heart. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. The simplest thing that can be uttered and sung by a child is for us the most glorious, mysterious lesson that will occupy us and our attention for the rest of eternity. That you love us, humbly love us, and that you welcome us home. Help us to enter into that. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. John replaces the story of the Lord's Supper with this story of a foot washing, not because the Lord's Supper isn't important, but it is so important that he wants us to get it right. He wants us to understand its meaning. And so he puts this narrative account of the foot washing. In verse 1, it was just before the Passover feast. Jesus knew that the time had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. And having loved his own who were in this world, he loved them to the end. He showed them the full extent of his love. You know, John's gospel is peppered all throughout with references to time or hour. In John chapter 2, Jesus tells Mary, his mother, the time is not yet come. And then all throughout the gospel, you hear that refrain, the time, the hour has not yet come, but there will be an hour, and it is coming. And then in chapter 12, just before this chapter, Jesus finally says, the hour has now come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Prominent hours figure into the life of Jesus because they are these hours of revelation, revealing to us something essential about his purpose and his nature. And the gospel has carried us along. First, the time has not yet come. Then the time is coming. And now, finally, the time has come. And God puts the spotlight squarely on Jesus to teach us something. The hour has arrived for the full display of his love. Now, if you have a different set of translations, if you have a Bible app and you can look up the NASV or ESV or NIV, and we tonight read from the NIV 1984 translation, if you read from the NIV 2011 translation, they have actually different translations because the nuance of this phrase, the full extent of his love, it's not simply captured. The NIV 2011 version and the NASB emphasizes the kind of time element to this phrase. And so they translate this, he now showed them, he now loved them to the very end. And that's to emphasize that whatever happens at this foot washing, it's an expression that Jesus loved his people to the very last drop, to the very end, he did not quit on his disciples. Now, it's one thing to wash the feet of an honored guest, someone that you like and trust. But what about washing the feet of the man that is going to betray you for 30 pieces of silver? Or washing the feet of the man that is going to deny you 3 times in a few hours? Or washing the feet of the disciples whom you begged in humility and even in humiliation? My heart is grieved to the point of death. Would you just stay up with me for an hour to pray in my profound need in the garden? And they're going to fall asleep on you. As you wash their feet, these are the feet that you are washing. Despite all this rejection, despite all that failure, despite the numerous ways that his disciples promised to be there for him and would only prove to fail, despite all of that, Jesus loves to the end. And I am certainly grateful, because as Jesus washes my feet, I have been that man to deny him for 30 pieces of silver. I have been that man to fall asleep on my Lord and Savior in an hour of need. And I'm grateful that Jesus doesn't give up on me. So he loves us, he loves you to the end. But it is a love that also has a fullness of commitment. And this, rightfully so, the NIV flip-flops, because it needs to flip-flop in translation. Both are true. Not only did Jesus love to the very end, but he loves to the full extent, to the ends of the earth. That's the other way that we understand the phrase of end. The end could be like, this is the end, at the end of a movie, the end. But it also could describe the full extent of something. And so we say, oh gosh, my love is going to pursue you to the ends of the earth. And that is to express the full extent of our love. And Jesus is saying that too. That he loves us wholly, completely, totally. There is no corner of the heart of God that he has protected, that he has reserved and says, you know, I can give you this much of my heart, but I'm not going to give you that part. Jesus, he has not reserved a single part of his heart. He has let it all out for you. It is a love that endures. It's a love that commits. It's a love that redeems. And that's why this phrase, he showed them now the end of his love, the full extent of his love. It's the same words that are used by Jesus when he said on the cross, it is finished. He wasn't just saying that, oh, the end, I'm dead. Nor was he saying that this is the full extent of my love when he is saying it is ended. He is saying that what has ended on the cross is beginning for all of eternity. My death leads to life. This expression here is an expression in saying that whatever the foot washing means, it means that it is a display of a God whose love endures, a God whose love is fully committed, and a God whose love redeems. God whose love cleanses us and does so in an act of amazing humility. The full extent of Jesus' love on the cross is going to be foreshadowed in Jesus' foot washing here. In verse 3, Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power and that he had come from God and was returning to God. And so he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. Jesus knows his place in the universe. All things have been put under his power. He comes from the Father as the commissioned Son of God, and he's going to return to the Father as the victorious fulfillment of his purposes. But he's going to show this sovereignty. He's going to show this almighty power from God in a surprising twist of humility, because that's love. Jesus removes his outer clothing. We're going to learn later at his crucifixion. This is the same seamless robe that was of such great value that when the Roman soldiers stripped him naked, they didn't toss it aside. They cast lots for this robe because it was so valuable. You know, it's one thing to take on the slave's towel if that's all that you have in life. But Jesus purposely set aside something of great value, this seamless linen garment. He put it aside to take up the servant's towel. The ancients were no keener on the task of washing feet than we would be. Travel on dusty roads, wearing sandals, of course, that resulted in an accumulation of dust and grime and dirt. You go to the beach, you run around, and your feet get dirty. You know that. But it wasn't just quite like walking on a dusty road. You need to understand, in the ancient world, they did not have a sanitation system as we do. Their cities were often composed of just a few main roads paved with stone, and then a lot of side roads that were paved with more than just dust. There was very little of any sort of indoor plumbing. And so you had to do something with your human excrement. And it would often entail just getting dumped out onto the streets. In fact, this was so prevalent in the ancient world that there was a job called the manure merchant. And they would be hired by the wealthier folks in order to clear out that excrement and to put it in cess trenches. Now, this is the grime that Jesus has to wash away. It was such a distasteful thing to do that Jews weren't allowed to let other Jews do this. Even a slave wasn't, a Jewish slave wasn't allowed to do this. You had to get a Gentile slave to do this because it was so demeaning. And this is what Jesus chooses to do. Now, if there's ever a person who is overqualified to serve, who had every right to pull rank and say, you know, not me, I think Judas deserves to do this job. It would be Jesus. I mean, look at his occupation. Look at his resume. Occupation, Son of God. Hometown, heaven. Right? References. Well, God the Father, God the Son, God the Spirit. You know, good references. Job experience. Well, you know, I created the universe. I mean, this is a person who had every right to pull rank. But he ultimately lays aside the glory, not only the glory of his outer clothing, the glory of his garment of divinity, the one and only Son of God, a glory which he had from eternity past and he will have for eternity future, lays it all aside. Philippians 2 talks about this. But he made himself nothing, taking on the very nature of a servant. A servant who washes off the worst sort of human grime off of his disciples' feet. And taking on the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness and being found in the appearance of a man, he humbled himself. and became obedient to death, even death on the cross. Philippians 2, perhaps one of the earliest Christian hymns sung by the church. This is a God who loves us with a deep humility, who looks at the sin of our lives, the absolute grimiest sin in our lives. And he tenderly takes our feet and he wipes it away. This is a love willing to bow its head under the mocking crown of thorns, fashioned by a people who so lightly reject his offer. It is a picture of a God totally out of sync with any of the Greek myths. Zeus, Apollos, Athena. This is a God unlike any other God. This is a God totally out of sync with anything that we would encounter in this world. Love with this kind of humility. A humble God. A God who is absolutely approachable. A God who, before he was on the cross, wanted to give a living illustration of what he was going to do on the cross. And to take the grimiest, worst part of human existence and to wash it away. When we come to this table tonight, we are coming to a foot-washing God who loves us and for whom we have nothing, nothing that ought to hold us back. Jesus loves you because the Bible says it. And it's this loving hospitality that throws open the arms and embraces people to come inside. In verse 6, he came to Simon Peter and said to them, Lord, are you going to wash my feet? And Jesus replied, you do not realize what I am doing now, but when later you will understand. And Peter says, no. Now, Peter, it's not just that he's being stubborn. He is recoiling as any good disciple should recoil. There is no way that I'm going to let you wash my feet. That is so incredibly demeaning. There is no way that I could live with myself if I let you wash my feet. That kind of dishonor. How could I call myself a disciple and let you do this? No, says Peter, you shall never wash my feet. And Jesus answered, unless I wash you, you have no part with me. And then Peter does what we expect him to do. You know, this is a complete all or nothing guy. Then, Lord, not just my feet, but my hands and my head as well. And Jesus answered, a person who has had a bath needs only to wash his feet, and his whole body is clean, and you are clean, though not every one of you. You know, Jesus here, he's making it very clear that this foot washing is not primarily an expression of servanthood, though it is that. It is an expression of salvation. A humble God that seeks to save us in an act of hospitality. You know, foot washing is something that a host makes sure happens for all his or her guests. We see this in this beautiful and haunting story in Luke chapter 7. Where Jesus was invited to Simon the Pharisee's home. And of course, Simon is laying a trap for Jesus and wants to catch him up in some contradiction. And Jesus walks in and he's engaging with them. And in the middle of the dinner party comes this sinful woman. And he washes Jesus' feet, not with the servant's towel and a bowl of water, but with her own tears and her hair. And Simon looks at Jesus and just inside is saying, if this man were a prophet, he would know what kind of sinful woman is washing his feet, and he would not let that happen. And Jesus responds to Simon in Luke chapter 7, verse 44. Simon, when I entered your house, you gave me no water for my feet. You did not anoint my head with oil. But this woman has wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. She has been forgiven. For he who has been forgiven much loves much. Jesus associates the foot washing with an act of hospitality that is, in fact, the essence of salvation. Salvation is an invitation to come back home. It is an invitation to all the prodigal sons and daughters. In whatever pigsty of life that we may have gotten ourselves into, it is an invitation for all of us to come back home. So when we come to this table tonight, we come to a God who tenderly, strongly, fiercely, to the end, with a whole commitment, declaring on the cross, it is finished so that I could begin it. A God who loves us in a surprising twist of humility. In order to wash our feet at this table and to invite us to our eternal home. And when we are to follow in his footsteps, this is what we do. This is why we have communion dinners in the evening. We invite you to this physical table because of the reconciliation that takes place between us and God who calls us home. But we invite you to the table downstairs to share a meal with one another. Because home is a place for all of us, for all of eternity. Now, you need to understand, the people that you see around you, you're going to be eating dinner with them for the rest of eternity. And so what we do tonight in inviting each other to this table and inviting one another downstairs is we're just having our appetizer for the main course of heaven with people that we're going to get to eat with for all of eternity. So your act of hospitality tonight, at the end of the service, just turn to the person next to you. Introduce yourself. And, you know, don't wait. I mean, we're just so good about this. We're such whiners nowadays. You know, no one's taking the initiative with me. Someone should introduce themselves to me. No, just you take the initiative because Jesus took the initiative. Introduce yourself to your neighbor and say, hey, I'd like to start on the first course. I'm going to be eating with you for the rest of eternity. Let's get this thing going. And go downstairs, and we have this twist tonight. We're going to have Middle Eastern food to follow up our discussion last week on the Syrian refugee crisis, and we're going to add the element. For those who are interested, Julian and Andrea are going to be at a couple of tables dedicated to how do we not only extend hospitality to one another, but what would it mean to extend hospitality to the refugee? And how, as a church, can we be involved? So if you want to be a part of that discussion, I mean, that's like an extra bonus opportunity to engage in this ministry of hospitality. Come tonight. Love each other, because that's what we do at this table. I'm going to invite the band to come up, and as we turn our hearts to the offering, recognizing